You used to have to wait for Drake to catch on to things. Now he's very quick. It's like the Drake effect. It's like he's closer and closer on the trend. So pretty soon he's going to be trend-setting, which is like the big jump.
DJ, producer, mogul, Diplo. It's actually kind of hard to keep track of all of the hit songs and all of the artists that Diplo has collaborated with over the last few years. He's said, at least, to be worth over $15 million. He plays over 300 shows a year. But more importantly, Thomas Wesley Pence has an almost uncanny ability to shift musical culture and predict changes that are coming down the pipeline. But where it all starts is not necessarily where you might expect.
I wanted to go back. Once upon a time, long before music, you were a school counsellor in Philadelphia, and I've heard you say that it was both the most rewarding and the hardest job that you've ever had. And I was wondering, like, if you could break it down for me, which parts of it were rewarding and which parts were the hard parts?
I think if you're a young person, anytime you have a job, it just sucks. Mm. And you're doing something for nothing. You know, you're working at packing groceries or moving something or cutting lawns, and the work you do doesn't translate into any actual meaning, right?
Right.
That's like what you get as a young person. So the fact that I was teaching or working with children, I felt like every time I went there, at least my work there could affect someone's life and the world could be a better place.
All right, people. Oto!
So on that side, it's like a job where I felt like I had a purpose when I went to work. On the downside is Philadelphia is like a pretty rough city, you know? So I dealt with problems like kids weren't able to go to school because their mother couldn't afford shoes, or or their mother was arrested, or they were beaten by their parents.
Here's the agenda. I want everybody sitting down, Keontae, especially those of you who haven't been in this club before.
Well, you know, most of the kids I taught didn't know how to read. They were 13 years old, and they faked reading, and they got that far in school without having to read, so it becomes really difficult.
And in that process of working with the kids, what did you learn about yourself?
If I missed a day of school there, if I missed a day of work, it affected someone's life. Mm. When I called in sick for another job, it didn't matter much. So I had to be pretty responsible as working in a school. You know, these are kids that showed me a lot of stuff too about music, and these are kids that influenced me a lot back in those days. They spent all their time in between classes, in recess, looking online at Baltimore and Philly club websites, listening to underground music. These little kids, they are obsessed with club music. They thought the style of music I was playing was still kind of another generation. And I realized how quick music translates and turns over for children and how much passion they had about it. It reminded me of when I first was in love with music, you know?
I've heard you say that music always changes, but it always changes in favor of the fans, not the artists. And that's something that artists just sort of need to deal with. And as you look around at the music business at the moment, what is it that artists should be adapting to right now?
I've always found the reason I'm here today and even to start a musician as a full-time job is because I've been able to navigate when technology changes. When bootleg CDs were big in Philadelphia, I made a lot. I bootleg my own music, I bootleg other people's music. I made enough money to buy a house back then off of selling CDs door to door. Give it away for free on the internet when that was a thing. Attack the streaming services with groups like Major Lazer when major labels were ignoring it. I was just trying to find my hustle, and I've always been someone that's in the fringes of music, producing different kinds of acts and working with different artists and mixing genres and mixing with different people that you have to understand that's how music is going to change. Technology is going to benefit the audience always.
I just wanted to go back to your history with Australia for a second. So in the year, I think it was 2007, you went to a place in regional Australia called Maningrida, and you worked with a bunch of Indigenous kids making rap music, making dance music. Why? What was it about those group of kids that made you want to do that?
I think I'd only been to Australia two times at that point, and I was really obsessed with it. Before I was doing it, there was a guy there, and he was recording really cool rap music with local kids, Aboriginal kids, and they had a really weird, delicate, they pick and chose different parts of hip-hop they created their own hip-hop with. And I I was always touring Australia, and I was always playing for like white kids. So I was like, well, how can we, if I do these shows at these big raves for like all the kids who got money, how can we do something cool for these little kids who I'm actually like into? And the cool thing about Australia, they really do a lot of outreach for kids, especially through music, a lot more than America, where there's a lot of red tape. So I thought, let's do something. And we just went up for like a weekend to Manangarita. There was a lot of cool ska music getting made, and like one kid made like a New Order song, and I just thought like I could use my influence to do something like that with these kids, because eventually these kids hopefully will be the cultural ambassadors or like trendsetters that will influence the rest of Australian kids, and like just kind of just stir the pot a little bit to make different music happening in Australia. That became a catalyst for what Heath Decent was. I think it's still running. This is like 10 years or more now. Welcome to my house on Bacandy Land with my dog, my cat. The idea was that we do that there. We could make a good example of something like that to do in America, but it's really hard in America to do anything like that. Honestly, people think music is like, when music is in the hands of kids, it's like a bad thing.
Why do you think that idea prevails in America?
I think Australia seemed to be a country that was like, yeah, we want to help these kids no matter what. This is important to like create some opportunities for everybody. America, like, we're kind of like, you make your own opportunities. That's kind of like the atmosphere here. People are afraid when like young kids have power and the music is given to them and to empower themselves. That's the kind of temperature we have here. Shouldn't be used to empower children, which is a fucked up way to think about things.
Before I came up for this interview, I was watching the video for Jack U, Where Are You Now? If people haven't seen it before, you literally have people drawing on pictures of Justin Bieber. And it kind of struck me that actually is how people think about Justin Bieber. Like, he's not a person, he's a piece of popular culture.
Yeah.
And I was fascinated to know, in your experience as a guy that has worked with him, what is it that people misunderstand about Justin Bieber? Like, what is it that makes him special for you?
I mean, I think the video, when we first had the idea for it, it was like, even more extreme. Like, we're gonna have a performance art, like have Justin lock himself in a box in an art gallery, have people like throw stuff at him or like, you know, be around him, and like he was like literally on display for people because he was one of the most polarizing figures in the world. It's crazy because you either loved him, you know, you based your life around him like some believers in the young girls and boys, or you like hate him. He's the worst thing that happened to music, you know, because he's entitled and he's a little brat. So we wanted to discuss all that, like what it's like. Even the collaboration itself was so bizarre. Like, me, Skrillex, and Justin Bieber made no sense, but I kind of had a master plan about it, like why it would make sense to people, and it eventually it did. And eventually Justin had the biggest album of his life after this project and really refined who he was as an artist.
So what was the master plan? Like, how did you imagine it would work?
I just thought, like, at the end of the day, if you make good music, nobody can complain or like criticize who you are or what you do, because the music is essentially the message that affects you, and it's good and makes you feel a certain way. You can criticize someone's life and what they do and who they are. You might not understand them or even know the whole story, but if the music affects you and makes you feel good, you can't lie to yourself. You know, that's what we were thinking. The music is what matters the most. I'm just fascinated by human beings. I think we do such cool stuff. I think it's a fascinating culture that we all created. So I'm obsessed with humans, I guess. That's why I went to school for anthropology. There's nothing greater than studying ourselves, like what we do, what we're able to create and be, and what is it that creates culture? How do we create it? Like, what is it essentially that is culture? Each person in each place can interpret style of music differently. That's beautiful. I'm fascinated, like, by how to manipulate it and how to change it, and how does it change, and what does it mean? And because these things create what we are as human beings, you know?
Hey, Diplo, thank you so much for doing this with us.
Damn, that's it?
Yep.
We're good?
Yep, that's it. We're done.
All right, man, thank you.